Good morning, everybody. How was the hangover? Giles? Really? Okay, this is me, the one with the white arrow. I look like my dad, I just checked with the audio guys. Born in 73, raised in Holland, live in Holland, as you can see. Married, three kids, working for Schubach Phyllis. And I got myself into IT when I was about 18, but I'm actually a corporate communications guy. And that's what I studied. And because a lot of issues in IT are not IT issues, but communications issue, I ended up there and I stayed there, which was fine. I love it over there. In free time, I try to be a long distance swimmer. The long works, the swimming sometimes. If you want to find me on Twitter, nothing special going on Twitter, by the way. But then it says Linus Torvalds on the slide, and that is Sebastian. So Sebastian approached me, I think, 1.5 months ago. Are you going to Denver? And I said, well, I don't know, and it is far, it is a 15-hour flight, and we're busy at the office. And he said, well, but you might have to do the keynote over there. Oh, and how come? He said, well, we asked some other guy, and we are not quite sure if he can make it. And I said, well, who is that some other guy? That's a strike through. So that means two things. Either I'm almost just as important as Linus Torvalds, or the most probable one, that this community is not that big yet, and they can't find anybody for a keynote. And I think it's the latter. So, back to me. Am I the dead pixel? And what does that mean? And I came up with this slide because in my childhood I was a bit different. If my entire class supported Ajax, that is football, not soccer, I was favoring Ajax as well, but I chose PSV Eindhoven instead. And the only reason was because all the other guys picked Ajax Amsterdam. And that happened more often. And later, I found my football squad, the local football team. And later in the study, I was always the lonely guy, or at least the guy that was different. And then after my study, I finally found a group of people that were, well, more like me. Think before you say something. Don't brag about a lot of stuff. Do hard work because you like it. Do it together. And that meant that I'm finally, since I started in IT, with a bunch of people that really connect with me, that interact with me, where I feel at ease. And maybe you've seen the second photo on the bottom, that is the life of Brian. And maybe you know the scene that Jesus opens the windows after a night that Jesus normally doesn't have. And he opens the windows and the entire crowd is there in the street. And he says, go home, you're all individuals. And one guy says, I'm not. So sometimes I have the feeling that I'm not a guy, and sometimes I have the feeling I'm the crowd. I don't go into the eggs, that might be turning out in a political discussion, so skip that one. Then, back to November. In November, we had the CloudStack Collaboration Conference in Amsterdam. The keynote there on the second day, at 5 o'clock, was done by Mark Hinkle, and he talked about the why of CloudStack. And the why of CloudStack was going to Simon Sinek. And you all probably have seen the YouTube videos about him. The why, the why, the why. And if you think about it, he talked there about the human aspect. He talked there about the boy with a robotic arm. And he talked there about the fact that open source software and the people doing it are slowly but surely changing the world. And he talked there about living meaningful lives. And I figured that was so inspiring, that talk, And it was exactly what the conference needed, because we're all, of course, technical talks, hackathons, and this was the human aspect of it. It totally completed the conference back then. But the why, of course, is beautiful, live meaningful lives. But as we say in Dutch, the chimney must smoke. And that means that you must have enough money to have your business up and running. So meaningful lives is beautiful, but it is also a luxury. The two sentences I got from his presentation, I put them here. Of course, I cannot give his entire presentation from half an hour in 1 minute, so I won't do it. But he is very proud of the community and the people in there. Co-creating and sharing. The group of people I found and the way we are doing things changed rather drastically in the last 3 years. 3 years ago, we have had a summit in the company. And it is not about my company, but it's about the summit. It was based upon a theory called appreciative inquiry by David Cooperheiner. Maybe you've heard of it, maybe you don't. And basically, he says, you have to open up. You have to open up as a company. You have to open up as people, and you have to know what you're doing and why you're doing it. And he said, the first phase of doing that is the discovery phase. Please open up your mind and let new ideas get into you. Don't judge them too fast. Think about them, and then go to the second stage, and that is dream about them. What are your dreams? What were the most beautiful things that happened in your life? What made you going? What kept you going? What is turning you on? And that phase is so important, because if that is what you can do in your work, then you have the best position, the best place, the best job ever. And then the last two phases are building and deploying the stuff and really making sure that you deliver. And of course, that is the hard part. The dreaming is fun and nice, but we all know that the devil is in the details. That was 3 years ago. We did it as a company, but we did it not only with our company, we did it together with our customers, our partners, journalists, and it was an amazing experience, because it is scary to discuss the future of your company with all outsiders. But what happened is that all those people start dreaming the same things as we were dreaming. All those people said, you guys have to do things differently, but you already know it. That was the moment that we started building the cloud. We were in the early stages then, 3 years ago. It is also the... One step back. What you see as well now, especially after the credit crisis, and I don't believe it's a credit crisis, I think it is a crisis of trust. It is a crisis that people don't believe large entities anymore, because every time you do, you get messed around with. You can't trust people with your finance, you can't trust people with your private information, and that's even exaggerated by the post-Snowden era where we are in now. People want to have real connections. You have the business to business, business to consumer, but nowadays you hear human to human. And I think that is really happening on a higher level as well. The economy is changing, and this is still early, but in the long run, I think this will happen. So, we started with CloudStack. This is the stuff you probably know. 3 days in a row, CloudStack. Best bang for the buck. It works, it scales, it runs. The community is great. You're all here. All the things that open source could wish for. And yet, there is still some things to do. Our assignment back then was, and then I've talked enough about our and we, if we want to do things differently, we should build a cloud that is different than we are used to do. We were a VMware company, so the easy step for us would be install vCloud, have some training, and keep going. Now we said we are going to do things totally different. We want to have an environment that can be controlled with an API, that is secure, robust, scalable, And the last sentence got us into trouble, by the way. Don't use anything you ever used before. But it also got us into the situation where we are in now. We are in a situation that we are part of this community. And back then we were not. We are in a situation that we learned a lot of new things. We are in a situation that our entire company is transforming and transitioning because of opening up and being part of communities. But that is us. And then something totally different. 2 weeks ago, I went with some colleagues to, I must read it because otherwise you can't make it up, right? The pre-commercial procurement project for the Cloud for Europe market consultation. And there's a typo in there. It was last week, not next century. It was an afternoon. We got into the RAI Amsterdam, the conference center. There was a room half the size of this, packed with suits. And I didn't feel at home. They were talking about, how do I get my money fast? And they said it in polite sentences like, dear Mr. Commissioner, what is the budget for this pre-commercial phase? When can we subscribe to the RFP? What happens with my intellectual property rights? And the European Commission was there with a totally different reason. They asked two things, and they asked us to think about it. What are the gaps in our approach? And on the business processes in the European Union, which of those do you want to have automated in the cloud? So everybody got a 3-minute pitch. And all companies, names like Cisco, Atos, SAP, they got on stage and they did the product pitch. This is my cloud. It works, it runs, it's great. The next one, this is my cloud. It is even better, bigger, greater, cheaper. And it was quite embarrassing, to be honest, because it was totally opposite of what they were asking, but also how we think that we should do things. So if you look at the Cloud for Europe, they have a steering board. The Prime Minister of Estonia is chairing that board. In his board, he has the CEO of SAP. He has the CEO of Software AG. He has Werner Vogels. He has Accenture, Mercedes-Benz, some member states in the European Union. And what we said in our pitch, or in our 3 minutes, said, what I'm missing here is the open source community in your steering board. What I'm missing here is the startup community in this board. Because if you go back to the presentation of Mark Hinkle in November, all the innovation is happening, or most of the innovation is happening in those areas. And if you don't let them in your steering board, how are you going to do the things differently then? But on the other hand, who are you going to invite? Startup number 1011, or open source community member 55? And that's difficult. So they listened to us and they agreed with us, but they also have the issue, yeah, well, where do I turn to? I can't go anywhere. I can't invite some bloke and he cannot speak on behalf of the entire open source community. It doesn't work like that. The other thing that was being discussed there is a lot about the intellectual property rights. If you look at the new way of procurement in the European Union, they split it up in phases, and after every phase they can select a new vendor. So every vendor asks, yeah, but how do I protect my intellectual property of the previous phase if I'm not quite sure if I get the next phase as well? And there the same item happened, that people are still believing that they should protect and push the outside world away. And that's the reason why I put up this slide, because we are not there yet. This is how they are really thinking. And by the way, we were the only one not wearing suits. And by the way, we had one guy, maybe you know him, Funds. He made a statement about open source, and a guy from Cisco, I know his name, but I won't say it here, it would not be fair. He said, well, like this gentleman from Schubert Phyllis said. And Funds got up from his chair and he said, that's not what I said. You're lying and you're not listening. And that was great because it totally broke open the entire atmosphere. And everybody was like, hey, there are different people in this room this time. Every time it is yes, Prime Minister, yes, Commissioner. So that was a really fun thing to do. Last week I was in a seminar, breakfast seminar, Black Duck and Ellen and Overy. It was a very good seminar, by the way. It was about lawyers and open source software. In the room, all suits. In the room, discussions about mergers and acquisitions. How do I value the code that is written in this company if I buy this company? In practice, a lot of organizations say, we do not use open source. If Black Duck does the scan, 30% of all code is open source. It's being included by developers. It is running on open source systems. But there is not a policy in those companies that they are using open source. So when they are buying or selling their company, then all of a sudden it becomes an issue, and then they start thinking about it. But before that, they are not really interested in how it is happening, because the deadline is more important, and the developer needs to meet the deadline. And if he does it by using open source, it's fine. And if he does it by using his own code, it is fine as well. But they do not think about, maybe it is better if a developer uses open source because he knows how to get the stuff done, not on his own, but being as a part of a member of a community. And if you are protecting everything again, you have to do it on your own or with a bunch of colleagues. The other thing was, again, intellectual property rights. They asked all kinds of questions about, and now I have to memorize it, I believe 750 different open source licenses, of which 22 are frequently used, and they are all not in the know. They don't even know they exist. They don't even know what they mean, but they are asking questions about it. And some of the people in the room, like a big chip maker from the Netherlands, banks, they said, to be honest, we don't ask those questions if it is commercial software. So why are we asking these questions now? Make me wonder. The third one, Harm and I went to England. It's always a nice trip to England because you can have lunch with Giles. But what even was more fun, we went there because of a bid. By the way, we lost the bid. I'm still angry about it. It's just not fair. But that argument doesn't work, so well. We went to gov.uk. During the bid at 11 in the evening, we were working at the office, and I mailed Mike Bracken. Maybe you've seen his talk about Code for America, about gov.uk, and I mailed him, Mike, we are working here with a bid for the government. Can we drop by so we can listen to your story, how you did it? We want to listen to how you changed culture and how you transformed your organization. 50 minutes later, I had the answer. You're more than welcome. My agenda is packed, but my team is there for you. Please drop by. That is a bit different than the previous two, right? We got there, and it was like coming home, that feeling. You see the picture here, that is on the walls, and the entire office is full with scrum boards, with creativity, with planning, with measurements about the websites. And two guys, or one guy and one girl there talked to us, Josh Russell and Abby Peel. And Josh said, the first thing we did is we need to work with a lot more companies that understand what we are doing. Currently, we are in the position that we work with 5 companies, and we are stuck. It's costing too much money. We can't go forward. We can't go backward. We have to cut money by $1.5 billion in 2015. That's the amount of money we're talking about. So things must go drastically different. And what they did is they assigned a digital officer. I don't know his correct function title, but he was cross-departmental. So he was above the ministries, which meant that he was able to design new business processes with his teams. And they started with the most frequently used, and that was earmarking your livestock. And they got so much gain from it that the momentum was going very quickly. And when they did it, they came up with something new, and that is the show and tell, like the demo or die in Scrum. But the show and tell is done by people in the top. So people in the top have to do the demo, but they are, well, especially in the government, not the most IT savvy guys. So the designers and the developers make websites that are so easy to use that those top managers can do the demo or die. And those top managers are afraid of a failing demo, so they reach out to the developers and they skip all the middle management and say, hey, what are you building? Can you show me? Can I drop by Friday 4 o'clock and see what you're doing? And the middle managers there are in the squeeze. But the energy and the way they are doing this is way more like we like to do it as a company, but also we like to do it as a community. Opening up, do it together, share your expectations, share your dreams, share your lessons learned. What are your pitfalls? So we got home very happy. The day after we heard that we didn't get the deal, so we throw everything away. Of course not. If I talk to my customers and I ask them, what is your open source policy? They say they don't have one. They are scared. And they are scared because they don't know what it is. Linux and Apache web server. That's pretty safe. But everything else? What if it is abandoned? What if I don't know what the license means? And the people, are they reliable? They grow beards. This is 1 week. I think I do it for another week, just to shock the enterprise. Oh, dead pixel again. They wear funny t-shirts, not today. So they don't know and they are scared. But who is there to tell them that it should be done differently and that you don't need to be scared? And there's a big, big hole. And we can tell them as Superphilis, and we do. But we are only a small entity in the Netherlands. And what is the impact that we have on the global economy? That is, of course, next to nothing. But what we also learned with our customers, with the enterprises, is that those people are not that different than I am. They just have different dreams. They have different visions. They want to work in different environments. But every morning when they go to the office, they want to do something good. They want to have meaningful lives as well. They want to go home with a good feeling that they are a little bit better than the day before. So if that's all the same, and only the dreams are different, maybe, we are in the position to bridge that gap. I don't know how yet, but we are here with a group of people, so probably you can help me there. And I think this sums it up quite nicely. Who's playing golf with the CIO in the last 6 months? Can I see some hands? Nobody, I think. Maybe Giles? No? Sebastian, you play golf with the CIO? Why not? Yeah, can you fix it, Payne? But if we are not playing golf with those guys, by the way, I got my golf license. In the Netherlands, you have to have a license. And I suck at it so bad that I don't even want to be seen at the golf course with the CIO. But what if we are not playing golf with the CIO, somebody else is. And you know what they showed them? They showed them this. Blood red Oracle slides. They showed them VMware slides. They showed them Atlas Origin slides. Which is not bad, of course, because they have a business to run. But what the bad thing is that they don't see the CloudStack slides. They are not being told by a trustworthy partner that this is the right thing to do. There's only one exception there, and that is luckily we have Citrix, because Citrix is doing that. But Citrix is having a hard time as well. I had a call earlier this year with Samir and Mark, and I believe Steve Wilson was in there as well, about this topic. And I know that a few members of the PMC are worried about this, and I talk about it in our company. We are worried about it. Selling NetScaler Xen Desktop and Xen App is something different than selling a cloud product. And a cloud product is not the next version of a virtualized environment. So you must come in with a different vision, in a different board meeting, with different people, and that's a hard thing to do. And I think the land and expand method that Citrix is doing now is the right thing to do, because they keep close to their strengths, and from on top of that, they can build it out. But I'm quite worried there as well, because build it out means that there is the next step. And who is telling them what the next step is? Again, the same issue, I think. So what do we then as a company? How do we sell CloudStack? Well, we don't. That's strange. We have multiple customers running in the cloud. We have banks running in the cloud. But we don't sell it. Because what we sell as an IT outsourcer is reliability, security, scalability, all the big benefits that everybody wants to have. But we don't sell CloudStack. And that means that we are also not in a position. And maybe I can push it a little bit better, and maybe I can make a nice presentation for the enterprise architect. And of course, we need to convince them that CloudStack is a safe way of going forward, because they have their internal policies as well. But in the end, we are also not doing it. So to summarize, I think we have a few things to do, to fix. And those are not exactly the same, but yesterday there was a talk by Mark and Giles in the other room, or maybe in this room when it is split it again. I think we should be ourselves. The community should keep to its strengths. This is great. The people are great. The social interaction is great. Of course, we want to grow it a little bit because it is self-sufficient. But don't do anything different. Don't let yourself into doing things that you're wrong in, or rather bad in. Keep doing the things that you're very good at, because that's what's keeping you going. That is dreaming or living your dream. I think we should seek some parties that can act as a trusted advisor to the CIO. Yeah, consultants is the ugly word, because they're only in there for the money. More hours, more hours, more hours. But some of them are different. We talked with, example given, A.T. Kearney. They don't do anything on hourly basis. They do everything fixed price. Oh, that's interesting. Why are you doing it different? Oh, we are not consultants. We solve problems for customers. Hey, that's more like us. So I think it can be done. We have to look for them. And we must have time for them to work with them and come up with some information that they can work with. The third, we must have some material to present CloudStack as the viable alternative. If I have to do it now, I take the cloud platform slides and I use a lot of it, and then I redo it in a manner that it is a CloudStack presentation. But it is best effort, and I'm, as you can see, not the best guy with PowerPoint, so you shouldn't trust me with this important stuff. I think there should be a governing body. CloudStack Foundation, CloudStack Foundation, CloudStack Foundation. Sorry. No, it shouldn't be the CloudStack Foundation. It should be a governing body. And if it is the Apache Foundation, I'm fine with it. If it is the Linux Foundation, I'm fine with it. If it is the CloudStack Foundation, I'm fine with it. As long as it meets the goals. And the goals are especially this. We need to have some white papers. We need to have a magic quadrant as well. And I don't like building one or creating one, but somebody needs to talk to Gartner about it. Somebody needs to go to Forrester. We have a number of those analysts, and they are very friendly to us. But really putting their time and effort in is something different, and they should have one face to talk to. The fifth one is on the technical level. If you have Red Hat and OpenStack, and that's the first thing you learn about cloud, why should you leave? If the first thing you know is there's a package on the internet and it is Java CloudStack and it has a very easy installer and it runs on virtually any device, that would make things, I think, a lot better. If people have a cloud product in one evening and they use it and it is nice, they will keep using it because they like it. It is easy, They can show it the next day. I think this is a very important one, because if the young people and the new engineers are growing up with CloudStack, they're not growing up with something else. I'm over time already. Almost there. Marketing. Don't go into it anymore. So what does it mean for me? I just want to live my dream. I also want to have a meaningful life. I want to be good to this community, good to my company, but also good to my family. And my dream is to work to make the world, the IT world, a little bit better. There's a lot of crap out there, a lot of stuff sold that just doesn't work, only for the money. And having that said, I'd rather be a pilot as well. That was my first slide, by the way. I'd rather be a pirate as well. But as a pirate, I cannot get everything done. So we have a new captain aboard. It is not Jack Chip Sparrow. It is now Jack Spark Sparrow. And he's going to the other side. He's going after the Flying Dutchman. Maybe you've seen the movie. And I'm willing to follow him in my business suit. And if I don't come back, I hope you come looking for me. And that's it. Any questions? Somebody has some questions? Then, time for coffee. This is for the next time.
Thank you very much, Arjen. Very inspiring speech. Thank you.
You're welcome.